The joyful occasion of this important reunion of various Catholic schools of the region under the banner of Bacs demands a fitting conclusion. And I am deeply honored to have been tasked to introduce our guest who shall provide us with a closing keynote address. For the past 6 years, she has stood as a bastion of hope amidst the constant crisis faced by the country. She has faced numerous challenges and persevered in resolving them despite the immense limitations, from helping the poor and the marginalized to coordinating rescue efforts during times of calamity. She has served as the voice of reason amidst the cacophony of chaos, reminding the Filipinos to serve with competent leadership and unfathomable kindness. She is a carrier of movement, inspiring volunteers of various generations to help their fellow Filipinos under the Angat Buhay program. Despite the ads, she continues to inspire. Recently, she has been named a fellow of the Harvard Kennedy School's Center of Public Leadership. She is a fellow Bicolano who, like us, has faced a lifetime of storms and continues to remain standing with us, bearing the flag of radical love. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my deep honor to introduce to you our former Vice President of the Republic of the Philippines, Honorable Maria Leonora Leni Gerona Robredo.
Mabalos po, magturo ko po kita gabos. Most Reverend Rolando Tirona Tria, Archbishop of Caceres, Most Reverend Manolo de los Santos, Bishop of Virac, hindi ko alam kung andito si Bishop Joel Bailon, wala. Sister Maria Marisa Viri, wala din. Seiya President, Executive Director Alan Arellano. Of course, Father Robert of the Ateneo de Naga, Father Wilmer Tria, Seiya Kalba ito, Father Wilmer, President. Father Odin Ariola, Bacs President. Sister Celine Saplala, Bacs Treasurer, Father Arlene Cabangunay, Director of the San Vicente Parochial School of Camarines Norte, all the other participants who are here, school heads, the different representatives of the academic institutions in the Bicol region, marahay na hapon po sa Indugabos. Thank you very much for inviting me over. It is always a privilege to be invited. I feel so humbled dahil I am in the midst of people whose expertise is really education. Mas gulpi po ka muna aaraman sa kuya. Ang sa kuya lang na brush with education aside from our engagement with education in our Angat Buhay programs is when I taught at the USI for 10 years. Kadakol po din nakakaaram na nagtukduman ako. While I was a law student, I was a full-time professor during the day and attending law school at night. We have always been talking about how education is most important and how huge our gaps in education are, which the pandemic has further exacerbated. Dakulaon po ining concern that has been existing even before the pandemic. And lalo nga ning naging klaro, bigla po kitang napiritan na mag-shift to distance learning. The problems are more than just infrastructure. It is deeply ingrained in the system itself. Si June 2, 2022 World Bank report showed that the Philippines has the highest learning poverty in the East Asia and the Pacific region and among lower middle income economies. Maka heartbeat si findings kang World Bank kasi sinabi niya na 9 out of 10 Filipino children aged 10 between grade 4 and grade 5 are still struggling to read simple text. This problem, according to the World Bank, is compounded by the significant number of out-of-school youth, as 5% of primary school-age children are not enrolled in schools. The World Bank also noted that the Philippines was spending less on public education than its regional and income level peers. Pag hiniling ta si mga datos, medyo nakakahadit siya. Ang data hali sa World Bank sinasabi na ang Pilipinas nagsispend lang kita ning $569 per child of primary education age. Ano kita, 83.5% below the average for the East Asia and Pacific region and 29.5% below the average for lower middle income economies. $569 per child. Para i-imagine ta lang, ang pinaka-highest spender, Luxembourg, nasa $24,000 per child. Kita $569. Ang US, nasa $14,000 per child. Kita, deingani, $1,000. So, ano ang maaasahan ta? These findings are consistent with other international assessments over the past few years. Nahiling tanainiyo itong Southeast Asia Primary Learning Metrics of 2019, bago pa ini nag-pandemic, contains data and insights on learning outcomes for grade 5 learners in the region. The Philippines' average scores in reading, math, and writing were lower than those of other participating countries. Among 79 countries and economies that joined the 2018 Program for International Student Assessment, si PISA, the Philippines scored the lowest in reading comprehension and the second lowest in mathematics and science. Haluyon ko na inimpig pa para sabi na garo ako raot ng plaka. Grabe na talaga ang satuyang education crisis. Na dapat kitang mag-declare na talagang iguanang kitang education crisis para we can address the gaps properly. Di man pwedeng business as usual dahil kadakol kitang gaps na kaipuhan po, ano panuan. Yung number one, increase in budget. We need to increase our national budget allocation for education. According to the United Nations, countries must allocate an equivalent of at least a minimum of 6% of their GDP for education. In our case, ang 6% of GDP dapat sana around 1.3 trillion pesos. Pero over the past decade, we have failed to achieve this. Budget for education has never gone above 2% to 4% of GDP. Between 2010 and 2020, mas naglala pangon yan. Because for 2022, the budget for education was only 593 billion pesos, equivalent iniyo sa 2.82% lang kang GDP. Na ang encouraged kang UN, dapat sana 6%. So 2.92 is way off the 6% minimum. That is the standard of the United Nations. The proposed allocation now for 2023 is slightly higher at 666 billion pesos. Pero it is only 3.17% of GDP. Harayuon manggiraray sa 6% na minimum kota. I have been advocating early on that the national government should raise our education budget to meet the United Nations recommendations. Education should be prioritized at iniyo ano din ini standard by allocating at least 18% of the 2023 GAA, itong General Appropriations Act. Pero ang current proposal lang is 12%. So ang minimum sana is 18%. Ang current proposal is just 12% of the General Appropriations Act. Moreover, urgent needs for education and health should be addressed in the implementation of the Mandanas ruling. Pighiling tana si mga earlier na mga proposed na IRR. Mayo kitang nahihiling for na very strategic na directions for education and health. Raising our budget for education should be the first real step towards showing that we are serious with addressing the many problems that our schools, students, teachers, and communities encounter day by day. Our problems with infrastructure manifest in both physical and digital spaces. Sa physical nakita. Lack of classrooms is a perennial challenge in our education system. DepEd officials have revealed in a recent budget deliberations that there is a shortage of 91,000 classrooms around the country. Iniyo na nagirumduman ko kang ako district representative pa, I was questioning the formula that DepEd was using. Dahil ang actual na inventory ko kang classrooms, lack of classrooms in the third district, ibang maray sa inventory ninda. Day ko aram kung sinunod din da si proposal ko dahil igo akong proposed na formula. During my stint as Camarines Sur 3rd District Representative, I endeavored to finish my term with a zero backlog as far as classrooms was concerned. Doable siya. It was very doable with the help of the private sector. But Glenda happened in 2024. Typhoon Glenda happened. So the aim na achieve si Samuyang zero classroom backlog. During our stint at the OVP, we worked with the private sector partners to help build classrooms in many remote communities under our Angat Buhay program. We also found out that in many poor communities, high school students from the poorest of families end up dropping out because they live very far from the nearest public high school available. We sought to address this by first giving multi-cabs. Nung una po, nagtao kami ng multi-cabs in two municipalities in Eastern Samar where the dropout rates were very high, sa Balangkayan and Salcedo. But when we did a midterm assessment, we were not satisfied with the improvement. The improvement was very stark, but we were not satisfied with it. So we did a more in-depth evaluation of why we were not hitting the targets. Naaraman mi po duman na si mga multi-cabs mi, di nakakasakat sa mga bukid. So si mga nasa bukid, di man giraray nakakaklase. So while the vehicles were very helpful, they could only reach so far, still leaving behind students who live in the most remote areas. So we decided to help lower the rates of absenteeism and dropouts by building in-campus dormitories in public high schools. Dahil kulang man ang Samuyang budget, pinili bilang si mga haralangkawon si dropout rates. We did this in partnership with local government units and our Angat Buhay partners. So as of now, igwa po kaming boys and girls dorm sa Siayan in Zamboanga del Norte, which has been known to be the poorest municipality all over the country for so many years. Igwa kami sa Sumilaw in Bukidnon, also a girls and a boys dorm. And then we also built a dorm in Balangkayan and Salcedo, Eastern Samar. And our partners built two dorms also in Negros Oriental. And when we built the dorms, ang assessment nagpapahiling na dramatic ang improvement sa dropout rates. The stories of our student dormers were at once heartbreaking and inspiring. There were young men who want to become the first professionals in their families, who strive despite the distance and having to help their parents with work. There were young women who want to become flight attendants and teachers, who stuff their uniforms in plastic bags on the off chance that it would rain during the hours-long trek to school. Nagahali sinda sa mga harong nindaning maagahon, madiklong pa naglalakaw na sinda, naabot ang liwanag yaong pasinda sa dalan. Dawa maghali sindang alas 4 ng aga sa mga harong ninda, kadaklan sa inda nalilate pa sa 7 o'clock class, sa karayuan kan sa inang piglalakaw. Most of our dormers walked an average of 3 to 4 hours each way just to go to school. Day sinda nakaka-boarding house, tamayo man sindang kwarta, pampa-boarding house. So, simpleng-simpleng programa na maglaag lang ng dorm, life-changing. Life-changing for so many of them. Currently, we are building one dormitory in Infanta, Quezon. But this is the first dormitory that we're building inside a tertiary educational institution. Nasa loob po kang campus kang South Luzon State University. And we are very proud na ang dormers na maistadigdiyo are members of the Agta and the Dumaga tribes. And naaraman mi from the school officials that they are the first ones in their families na makakatungtong ng college. So imagine the ease that it will give the students if they can stay in the dorm for free, for them to be able to finish their tertiary education. On Thursday, I will be traveling to Labo in Camarines Norte. We're also building a dorm there. Tapos igwa pa kaming sarong dorm sa Capiz. Sa Capiz in the Panay Islands. All of this are privately funded. So our dormitory served as their second home, a place where they could stay and focus on their studies during school days, rather than have to spend hours before and after classes every day walking through rocky trails, crossing rivers, and the like. As an aside, ini anecdotal pa, one of the first observations that we had when we were orienting our dormers is most of them will be using toilets for the very first time. So kaibanan siya sa orientation ka mga maistar sa dorm. These are things that we take for granted. The second infrastructure that we're failing miserably on is technological connectivity. And this was exposed further during the pandemic as students in many parts of the country suffered from poor or no internet connection, making the process of learning even more difficult. Pandemic or not, these areas include approximately 4,800 last-mile schools, or at least 10% of the total number of schools that lack connectivity. When we shifted to distance learning, this was the primary concern of students and parents. Mayong access ang estudyante sa internet, pati na din sa computer and gadgets. This was why our Bayanihan Eskwela efforts, which we started during the pandemic, began with a gadget donation drive. This was soon followed by the production of instructional videos made available to the public for free. Si experience mi ka nagtatao kami ng gadgets, most of the students na sinerte na at least may sarong gadget for the family, ang gadget na available, cellphone. Cellphone na di man nakakabasa ni mga videos dahil mayon data. Tapos number two, sarong cellphone pigbabaranga-banga kang pirang estudyante sa eskwelahan. So, you know, minsan sabi ko nga ni sa mga aki ko, sabi ko kamo, nawawaran lang kami kitang wifi, nagpapanik na kamo. Pero si ordinaryong Pilipinong estudyante, talagang mayong-mayo. We have, one of our recipients was a vegetable vendor na who was in high school. Kang tinawanan mi siya, nakakaadal na siya, dawa, nagtitinda siya sa saud. Nagtitinda siya ng gulay sa saud, pero because of the gadget that we gave him, nagtitinda siya habang nagkaklase. Dahil it already allowed him to attend virtual classes. According to NEDA, the sudden and prolonged closure of schools is projected to redound to a productivity loss of 10.7 million trillion over the next 40 years. So papaano ta hahabulon si baya sa tuya na ang equivalent 10.7 trillion. Bago pa kita tinamaan kang pandemya, hababa ng maray ang learning levels kan sa itong mga estudyante as shown by various international assessments and which I have mentioned earlier. Learning outcomes are expected to have worsened because of learning losses brought by the pandemic and the gaping digital divide. Teachers and education experts have raised this concern early in the pandemic. So we worked with them for our Bayanihan e-Skwela initiatives. In producing instructional videos, pwede pa po nindong ma-view ang instructional videos, igwa kaming YouTube channel na Bayanihan e-Skwela. Subject matter experts from the UP College of Education and other related units helped us craft content to equip our teachers, parents, and guardians with the necessary skills to guide our learners. The said production involved the work of nearly 300 creatives na nag-volunteer for free. For our students, we opened a total of 129 community learning hubs all over the Philippines with the help of more than 1,600 volunteers and organizations who funded the said sites or provided training for our tutors. Aram po nindo, bago may binuksan si Bayanihan East Community Learning Hubs, we were already coordinating with DepEd. And at first, DepEd was very happy about it because the concept of Bayanihan, the concept of a community learning hub is that there will be a center in the community where students who do not have gadgets and students who need help with their modules can go and avail of trained tutors to help them with their modules. Kang inot ugma si DepEd, pero kang tinira kami kansaro sa mga cabinet secretaries. May mga LGUs na diin na kami tinugutan magbukas sa INDA. We are still thankful na 129 community learning hubs were opened all over the Philippines because schools were closed for 2 years. Pero nasasayang kami with the opportunity. If DepEd was only willing to partner with us, mas gulpi sana si natabangan ka ito. Pagkatapos ko po digdi at 4 o'clock, we will be opening another community learning hub in Barangay Sabang, in Naga City. We have, I think, 6 already in Camarines Sur. So we are excited about it. It was in the community learning hubs where we learned firsthand that many of our learners still struggle with reading and math. Igo po kami mga estudyante na high school na, hindi pa nakakabasa. And bako lang siyang exception to the rule, pero nagkakapira talaga sinda. And now, as schools return to face-to-face classes, we have decided to transform our community learning hubs into remedial reading and math centers. Learning needs to be assessed so that proper remediation programs can be designed and implemented at the start of the school year. We can start by forming a multi-sectoral commission that will develop a roadmap to measurably improve reading outcomes within 2022. The commission must have representatives from both houses of Congress as well as the private sector. Ini-discuss ko nilang iningdikit because there are catch-up programs already being launched now. Pero ang worry ko digdiyo, kung pinag-adalan talaga ninda, kung ano ang cost kang difficulty. Dahil masakit mag-ibong programs kung di man pinag-adalan, kung ano ang pinagpupunan. I will give you an example. The Jesse Robredo Foundation started reading programs in 3 places. In General Luna in Quezon, in Mulanay, Quezon, and in Naga. When I went home last August, I requested for a presentation of the midterm assessment. Prinesent sa kuya, gulping mga eskwelahan sa Naga, grade 1 students ini. Grade 1 students na may reading programs, DepEd was very happy with the program. Pigpipresent sa kuya si baseline, tapos si mid-level assessment, tapos ibang tapos na si final assessment. Okay man si performance kang kadaklan. Pero may saru o duwang eskwelahan na sobrang baba. Di ko nasasabihon si barangay, pero sarong eskwelahan digdi sa to, si baseline, 2% lang ang nagbabasa. At the end of the program, 39% na nagbabasa. Happy na si iba na from 2 naging 39. Sabi ko, di kita dapat maugma kayan. Ang 39% is still way below our targets. Pinag-aadalan mi, parehong-parehong programa. Pareho si training sa mga reading tutors. Pero taano ta itong one or two na eskwelahan, sobrang baba kang improvement sa pagbasa. Ang nahiling mi, itong mga lugar na ito are poor communities. And sa pag-delve deeper, most of the children are stunted. So dawa anong tukdo mo, kung ang mga aki stunted, talagang igualang hangganan si sa indang absorption. So right now, we're trying to transform our program. Nabako na lang siyang simpleng reading and math remedial program. Pero ibabale na si feeding. With the purpose of, pero ining feeding na ni bako lang for school age children, taaram taman baga na ang stunting is irreversible after the age of 5. So ang reading program sa mga lugar na mga kadakol na mga poor families, kaipuhan talaga magpuon pagbadus pa sana when mothers are still pregnant. So we are partnering with the Negros Volunteers for Change on the model. In fact, we launched the pilot areas already in Negros Occidental and in Iloilo. We're launching 2 more sites in Eastern Samar and in Northern Samar on September 26. So hopefully, ano pa lang ini pilot area, so hopefully mag-work siya. The ultimate goal is to raise the quality of education, to make better teachers, and as a consequence, even better students. May mga proposals kami, and I think these are the same proposals that everyone has been batting for. Number one, support and assistance to teachers. Education experts said that one of the reasons for learning poverty in the Philippines is the fact that our teachers are overworked. A separate World Bank study from 2016 found that teachers could only answer 4 out of 10 content knowledge questions in the subjects they were teaching. Teaching is also not seen as a desirable profession for high achievers. According to PISA, students who expect to become teachers scored about 42 to 45 points lower on average in reading, math, and science than their peers who expect to enter other careers. So, paano tagigibuho na mas attractive ang teaching sa mga matitibay? Kaipuhan pag-adalan siya as far back as that. So, it goes without saying that we need to invest in our teachers. How do we invest in them? Provide fair and competitive salaries, trainings, benefits, lalo na ngayon, in light of the pandemic, COVID-related support. More importantly, deload them of administrative tasks. Dapat kuta, focus na maraisinda sa pagtukdo, bako sa admin work. Ini importante because there are good models of this already. Organized communities of practice for teachers, school heads, and school boards at the provincial level so they can come up with localized ways to deal with COVID but also scale best practices of continuous high quality learning. We're also piloting this along with Sinerhia and the UP College of Education. So, naghahanap kami ng mga lugar na welcome kami para pwede kaming makapilot na to create this kind of community practice. Set up an international exchange and scholarship program for teachers and school heads for massive upskilling and professional development. Number 2, raising student aptitude. As a whole, the performance of our students is considered dismal in the world stage. International assessments have found that Filipino students do very poorly in reading, science, and mathematics. Kasi bago pig sabi ko na si standing ta sa PISA. Our national assessments have been criticized due to lack of consistency in schedule, implementation, and content. The National Achievement Test has been changed multiple times, putting into question the comparability of its results. Dahil siging ribay-ribay, masakit magkaigwang baseline para i-compare ta si improvements. So it has been very difficult for us to see trends and progress. Halimbawa, for example, from a competency-based question design, yung NAT shifted to the use of 21st century skills in its question since 2016. Then, kang 2019 and 2020, na-postpone man si NAT because of the pandemic. Also, we must roll out a national learning assessment program that will diagnose missed learning at the student and school level. Sa hiling ko, ini ang kulang. Kulang kita sa pag-adal kung ano ang pinaka-root cause. Pag halimbawa nagsabing, we are doing poorly, nagibo na tulos kitang programa na remedial programs, pero di itaman pig-aram kung taano arog ka to si performance ka mga estudyante ta. So ano ang in all likelihood, baka ang programa ta da irresponsive sa problema na pigpupunan. From this, we can create a remediation program that will address the gaps identified by such assessment programs. Moreover, instead of dismissing international assessments as mere criticisms, if you recall, kan nagluwas si international assessments kan 2019, pigkikriticize pa kang gobyerno na sala ngayon ini yung international assessments ani. Instead of criticizing the international assessments, we should continue to participate in such to actively trace improvements in our test scores. Dahil unbiased na assessment siya, na dapat sana ang aim ta ka, nahiling ta si dismal results ta kan 2019, ang aim ta na sa sunod na assessment, nag-improve na kita. Pero instead, ang ginibuta, pigka-criticize ta si assessment. Number three, the need for upskilling. We must also ensure that our students are keeping up with the changes of the times, fast-paced given technological advancements. We experienced this firsthand when we launched sikap.ph during the pandemic. Sikap.ph was our program. It was supposed to be a free online jobs platform where job seekers are matched with employers based on skills and location. In different parts of the country, partner companies came forward, nakipartner sa Muya, and we had 29,000 jobs available on our platform. Unfortunately, there were only nearly 18,000 applicants. Day sinda nakaka-apply dahil mayo sindakan si skills na pigahanap. So gustong sabihin, grabe si disconnect. Grabe si disconnect kang hinahagad kang industry sa pigpo-provide kang sa tuyang mga educational institutions. So we had so many jobs in Region 3, in the NCR, in Region 4A, in Region 7, pero very, very few had the skills that were being asked. We talked to representatives from mga call center agents, mga BPO sector. So we were asking them, niyaon sa in ang problema? Ang sabi ninda, they had so many jobs available, lalo na ang software technology na mga taong kaipuhan. Pero mayong skills ang mga estudyante, ang mga graduates, even those coming from the prestigious academic institutions. So ang hapot mi, taano taarog ka iyan? Ang sabi ninda, dahil ang pigtutukdo na mga software, pase na. Ang pigtutukdo na mga software, di imi na yan ginagamit sa industry. So pigahapot mi sinda, taano ta very stubborn pa ang academic institutions na tinutukdo pa ninda si mga software na di inamin nindo gamit. Ang presumption of the BPO industry is, si mga teachers mismo na nagtutukdo, di na-updated. So, ang sakuya lang, kadakol ang pwedeng gibuhon ka ini, na dapat si mga programs na ino-offer sa mga eskwelahan, dapat after much consultation with the industries, kasi sayang si mga jobs na hinahanap, na mayong nakuko ang malaog, tas kadakol ang mayong trabaho. Diba? Kadakol ang mayong trabaho, kadakol ang jobs na available, pero si disconnect is very apparent. According to the International Labor Organization, 18 million Filipino workers are at risk of losing their jobs in 20 years' time due to automation. So, dapat talaga mag-upskill kita. Kundi, kadakol ang mga kaaramanta na dai nakaipuhan. Moreover, only about 5% of total employment in the analyzed occupations are engaged in rising star occupations. So, we should invest more. Pero I think government should be the one to propel this. Kaipuhan ang gobyerno, nag-i-incentivize siya. Nag-i-incentivize siya for the academic institutions to be more responsive to the skills needed by the industries. For this, arugan sabi ko subago, we must create an upskilling voucher program for lifelong learners to prepare them for jobs of the future. And hindi kadakol opportunities na data pig to take advantage, lalo na during the pandemic. There are a lot of private academic institutions which closed down. Diba? Kadakol si nag-close down dahil di na kinakaya. Kadakol mga academic institutions could not provide the same level of incentives and allowances and salaries to the teachers na kaya kang gobyerno. Pero dapat ang gobyerno hinihiling niya ang private schools na partner. Diba? Di niya dapat pigihiling ang private schools na kalaban kang public schools. Kundi dapat tinatabangan niya ang private schools para si kakulangan kan si public schools, private schools ang nagpapano. I think this is one area where we are sorely lacking at. Parang ang feeling na most of the private schools are left to fend for themselves without much help from government, which should not be the case at all. So government should help private schools more, and they would help private schools more if they view private schools as partners, not as competitors. Next, I discussed this a little earlier, ensuring nutrition to ensure learning. For many poor communities around the country, nutrition or lack thereof is a make or break factor for the success of students. Malnutrition, which can result in conditions such as stunting, affects not only physical growth of children, but their intellectual development as well. May istorya lang ako, madali, halawigo na po ang sa kuyang pigtataram, pero istorya ko lang from experience. When I was in Congress, I looked at the malnutrition status of the 3rd District, which I am representing, without naming the towns. There were a few towns na very alarming ang malnutrition rate. I visited those towns trying to make sense of why that was so. Duman sa mga lugar na grabe ang stunting, igwaman mga existing na mga feeding programs. May mga existing na feeding programs, pero garo dai masyadong concerned sa metrics. I tried to ask for the accomplishment reports of the feeding programs. Pigihiling ko sala na maray ang metrics kasi nakalaag ang accomplishment, mga 500 children fed. Pero it's not the number of children you feed, di ba? But how the nutrition improved. Garo, sabi ko, ang sabi ko kato, garo kulang na maray sa metrics. Pero it was so much more than that. When we launched an honest to goodness feeding program, I did not want to start it without the baselines. Kang nagbe-baseline, mayong baseline. So I was teaching them how to make baselines. Kadakol ang nagsusulisit sa kuya ning tape measure saka mga bathroom scales na mga barangay nutrition scholars. So I was asking, ano ta nagsusulisit ka mo ning tape measure saka mga bathroom scales? Sabi ninda, yung nga ang gamit mi. Pero ang standard, di ba, sa malnourished children, dapat salt or weighing scales. Saka mga height boards. So, mayo da asinda ka yan. Itong one town, for all the barangays, there was only one salt or weighing scale and one height board for the entire town already. So, I went to DOH. My purpose of visiting DOH was just to ask, saan ba kita makakahanap ng salter weighing scales and height boards? And then, DOH showed me their warehouse, punong-puno ng salter weighing scales and height boards. And DepEd was saying, walang nagre-request. So, alam nyo yun, grabe yung disconnect. The resources are available, pero the end beneficiary did not even know that they can request the resources that they needed. Ang mga barangay nutrition scholars, hindi si mga nagfi-feed sa mga aki, some of them receive 500 pesos a year as allowances. So how will they support their families if they are given 500 pesos a year? So just goes to show how unconcerned we are with the outcomes. Garo concerned lang kita permi sa proseso, pero sa outcomes dai. So I tried to change many things, pero we can only do so much. We try to learn also from other places because there are other government programs that are really worth replicating. And kaipuhan lang talaga siyang adalan, pero yung nutrition and education cannot be separated. Lalo na sa mga very poor communities. We recently launched Angat Bukas. Ito yung sinabi ko, minention ko kanina. We recently launched Angat Bukas, which is a convergence program with the Philippine Business for Education, the Philippine Business for Social Progress, and Negrense Volunteers for Change. With this, in-school feeding programs will be conducted by tapping local farmers to produce the ingredients, and mothers and volunteers to cook and distribute the meals. We are piloting this, as I've said earlier, in Negros Occidental, in the town of Himamaylan, and in Haniway in Iloilo. Both towns having recorded high malnutrition rates. So, taano't takabali ang farmer sa Urulay? Kasi ang nutrition is also a product of poverty. So ang gusto ta na si mga magurang kan si mga malnourished children matatawan ang taning hanap buhay. So right now, aside from getting from small farmers the produce that we need for the feeding programs, ang pigaadalan taman papaano ta i-employ si mga magurang kan si mga aki para sinda si nagpe-prepare kan si mga kakanon. So that is what we are piloting right now. Na for the entire supply chain, nakabit-kabit siya si nutrition saka si education. We know that during the pandemic, private schools, araw kan sinabi ko si Bago, also struggled to stay afloat. Some 425 private schools have decided to permanently close down because they were unable to sustain their operations due to the challenges brought by the COVID-19 over the past 2 years. Na-mention ko na inisubago. Pero we all know that many private schools, especially your private schools, cater to low-income students. It would help a great deal if government will increase and expand vouchers and subsidies to private schools. This will allow us to leverage private sector resources and expertise in education delivery. One of the main realizations for us in Angat Buhay, under Angat Buhay, over the course of the 6 years that we were at the OVP was, there were just so many private individuals and organizations who want to help. They just don't know how. So, dapat ang gobyerno should provide that platform na di pwedeng gobyerno kami, private kamo. Pero dapat ang gobyerno sets the stage, di ba? Na si may capacity na magtabang, nakakatabang sa mas nangangaipuhan ng tabang. So, that should be how it is, especially as far as education is concerned. So, ira-wrap up ko na ta, medyo haloy na ako nagtataram. So it bears reiterating that all the work ahead of us requires collaboration between government and the private sector. And as we say often, it takes a village to raise a child. So sa pagpaparahay kang kamugtakan kang edukasyon, sa Pilipinas, the same applies. Kinakaipuhan talagang magtarabangan ang gabos, ang gobyerno, ang mga communities, ang private sector, ang mga organizations, ang mga ordinaryong mga namamanwaan para masiguro na handa ang mga masunod na henerasyon sa mga hamon ng babagong panahon. I am not here although I mentioned recommendations, I don't have the answers to all the problems that I indicated. Pero ang one thing I'm sure of is that government should provide that platform where the best minds in the education sector will come together. Na tinataonan boses ang gabus so that responsibility kang gabus ining sa tuyang education crisis. Di talaga pwede na dikit lang ang nag-uurulay. In many of the pilot areas that we're looking at, the best programs are usually those born out of platforms where the private sector can contribute. So siguro iyon si pagtapos kan sa kuyang message ko niya nahapon is to challenge everyone to keep on pushing. Di pwedeng inaako talang si sistema. Ang ills kang education yaon sa sistema, mayo lang sa sarong tao. So kaipuhan tarabangan ta na we continue pushing until we get we just don't get the desired results. Pero si mga kairibata will take it upon themselves na ang problema kang education is not just with the education sector pero problema kang gabos. I would like to thank all of you for coming over despite the busyness of the season. I would like to congratulate all the organizers of this event. Mabuhay po kamo gabos, maray na aldaw sa Indo gabos.
Thank you, Attorney Leni.